More than ever, we now see a regional approach to sustainability. During the conference, three interesting examples passed the review. Chris Ash, researcher at Dundee College, tells about the waterfront of Dundee City.
So, I'm going to speak about Dundee Waterfront project, which is the largest capital project in Scotland.
Why Dundee Waterfront? Because we are situated in a very, very beautiful part of the country. We don't exploit the natural resources that are on our doorstep. And that is the concept of Dundee Waterfront, is to open that up to exploit the natural resources. One of the major industries that is starting to emerge on the east coast of Scotland is offshore wind, approximately worth 100 billion euro over 10 years. And Dundee is ideally placed for the manufacturing of fourth generation wind turbines. There's an understanding now within Dundee City and its region that as we go forward and we look at sustainability and we look at energy, that the wealth that is created from that is contained within its region. So that's what really excites me about North Sea Set, because it's necessary that the region benefits. And ultimately, it's people that need to benefit. Because if the people buy into it, then you won't have the objectionists. And that's really a clear message.
The presentation continues on the theme of innovation. Not so much on a building level, but more on product level. Brissette shows what the students of industrial design are capable of.
Why are we focusing on these things, on the demand side of energy and on products? Because as you are all aware, all of you have four or five televisions, so many computers, so much ICT behind it, and it's growing and growing. And of course, it's a good thing that we work on sustainable energy supply on one side, but if we don't focus first on the demand and make that more efficient, it won't make sense. In other words, it's time that we focus on products and all the things that consumers is not only residents, but it's also people using transport, the cars, that we focus on all these things and the user behavior. So since almost 20 years now, we look at, in the first place, individual products. Can we make the equipment that we have here in the building and that requires heat or that requires electricity, can we make it more efficient? Here you see the micro CHP, the micro combined heat power installation. In the north, we are testing this again on the island of Ameland. It means that instead of a normal boiler in your home, well, gas comes in the future, biogas comes in, and you produce heat and you produce electricity. I take you to my experiment. It's hard to read, but this is my garden. There is my garage. And in the garage, it's a mess, but you see here also my micro CHP. So I'm testing that one. And that's really fun because from that, I deliver 50% of my energy to my own home. Other inventions and new things are coming up very quickly. This is a polymeric solar collector designed by one of my students who got a patent on this. A very clever guy. And he designed a polymer-based thermal boiler in which he uses, well, some technologies. In fact, it makes the solar boiler a factor two cheaper, so 50% of the price. This would mean a breakthrough. How do these new products help? And otherwise, if I have an interesting solar product here, is there some minister on the top that can help me? Well, there are levels in between, but the idea is that between, let's say, these innovations at the product level and the policy level, we speed up things and steer things much quicker and more intelligent. What I expect is that in the future, there will be many more new design solutions that are connecting, like we also heard from the nuclear energy from Japan, that are connecting connected to things like health, but also fun and gaming and these things that young people and that we like too. So for me, the future is this sustainable dance club. This is, I still have a patent on this. So, you know, we can generate energy by dancing. If I had my dance floor here now, you would see some lights coming up. Particularly, you would do like this. That okay? Sorry. And so my idea was, well, let's do some interact dancing either tonight or why not today. Thank you very much.
The North Sea Commission wants to promote the results of North Sea SEP all over Europe.
What I'm going to tell you all is something about the North Sea Commission. So the CPMR is the umbrella organization of the North Sea Commission, and we have six commissions. We represent 161 regions, which is 28 EU member and non-member states, which roughly works out to about 200 million inhabitants. So it's a strong voice that goes to Europe. When it goes through the North Sea Commission to the CPMR, it becomes a strong voice. If you all want to develop a policy paper, and you can get it sent to one of the North Sea Commission groups where we will work on the paper, develop the paper, and send it up to the CPMR for adaptation, and then there onwards they will forward it on to the Commission. So it is a strong voice.
Hans van Meerendonk believes that islands form an ideal testing ground and the perfect basis for promoting renewable energy.
The philosophy is if you develop a product like a table or a chair, make it of such substances that you can, for 100%, use it for another product when the time of those table or chair is over. So when it's not, you cannot use it anymore. We see islands as a kind of independent areas. From the very past, they always needed to survive and to fight for the resources. So it's in the genes of the island inhabitants. So they like innovations, and if you can demonstrate innovations in this kind of areas, it will be good examples for the rest of the world.
We hear a different story from Mr. Per Heller, council member of a small municipality in Denmark.
The good news are that we have a government in Denmark, and the government has recently come up with an energy plan, which is extremely ambitious and probably the most ambitious one, at least here in Europe. We have to be in 2050. We have to be totally independent of fossil fuels. No coal, no oil, no natural gas. But we have to develop the technologies for that first. We are not going to involve the municipality as such as an energy producer. We have companies for that, and we have to guide these companies. We have to help the companies. We have to facilitate their work. But it's not up to us as municipality actually to produce things.
Energy Valley in the north of the Netherlands and Niedersachsen in Germany cooperate on a higher level. Koos Lok, representing Energy Valley, informs us that the energy sector is growing fast. Billions are being invested, forming a boost for the employment in the area.
The Energy Valley region is the northern part of the Netherlands, and it entails the three provinces, Groningen, Drenthe and Friesland, and the upper part of North Holland. What we are doing in this part of the Netherlands, we are working together in a sort of a triple helix concept. And that means that the private sector, the public sector, and the knowledge institutes are working together in this part of the country to develop sustainable energy and to develop business related to sustainable energy. What is going to happen in the forthcoming years, in the forthcoming 10 up to 15 years, there will be a lot of wind power. That wind power will be in the North Sea. That wind power will be between the 20,000 and 40,000 megawatt. And it's located before the coast of the Netherlands, northern coast of the Netherlands, the northern coast of Germany, Denmark, UK, Sweden. All those countries will have offshore wind power. If you combine these countries within one structure, you're really going to have synergy with respect to knowledge and potential, the development of potential projects.
The third speaker on innovation has traveled a longer distance. David Jarovic of the Aarhus Construction Company in Sweden presents the one-ton life concept. His story in a nutshell: we all produce about 7 tons of CO2 per person per year.
One ton, one future. For you to get a picture, if you had a budget, a one ton life per person per year, in existing buildings, and what you have mostly of the people inside here today in your homes, your budget could exist of, you can either heat in your house, but you can only do that every fifth day. Or you can eat 2 meals of meat each day, but then you cannot heat your house. Or you can use your existing car and travel 10 to 20 kilometers per day. Then you cannot stay in a warm house or eat your burgers. The climate shell is one of the most important things when we're talking a climate smart house. Well insulated and tight house is one of the most important things when it comes to a climate smart house. We have calculated the total amount of CO2 emission of building this house with everything in it. The total picture is about 70 tons. And the foundation, the concrete in the foundation, stands for about 40%. Remember, we have minimized the number of concrete in the foundation. On the house, towards the south, we have solar cells on the wall and also on the roof. The solar cells give electricity to the white goods, and we are also able to charge our electrical car that are connected. In general, over a full year, we are producing more energy in this house than we need. You're free to go into the One Ton Life website. There you will find a lot of information regarding this project.
Well, it started out down a dirty road. Started out all alone, and the sun went down as it crossed the hill, and the town lit up, the world got still. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. The hardest thing, well, the good old